properly. Okay, good, good. Happy to hear that everyone can hear me properly. Just let's wait a bit and see. So, other than Laboni, everyone else is from Kerala. Are there people outside Kerala? Anyone else from outside of Kerala? So hello to everyone and welcome to this class. Now let me just give a small introduction. I'm Anita Menon and I teach at IGNO RC Kochi, Kerala. And the class that I'm going to take for you is MEG 3, that is British Novel. Okay, now I will soon get into my PowerPoint presentation and I will be giving you explanations regarding the novel that we are going to deal with today. And then we can take it from there, okay? And when I ask you to unmute your microphone, you can unmute and try to give me answers because I will be asking questions in between. Not tough questions to scare you, but just simple questions. Just to know that you guys are listening to me, okay? All right? Okay. So let me start presenting now. Let me go take out my... Forgotten how to... Can you just give me a moment? Can you see what I'm presenting?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Can you see the first slide?
No.
Ma'am, at present, your Google Meet window is open.
I've gone to this. Can you see my PowerPoint presentation?
No. I can't.
No, ma'am.
Yes or no?
No, ma'am.
No, of course, no.
No, ma'am.
No, no, okay. Ma'am. Okay, just give me a moment. Okay, let me stop presenting. What about now?
No, I think.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. So you can see the first slide. I'm assuming everyone can see the first slide.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Just give me a moment, okay? Okay. Can you see this?
Yes, ma'am, it is visible.
Okay, all right. So, in between, if there is, because I will not be seeing your chats now, so if there is any question, you will have to ask me. You know, you'll have to audibly ask me, okay? Because I'm going to be, you know, looking at this PowerPoint presentation only, okay? All right. Now, I'm, you know, assuming that all of you have taken MA English Literature because this is a favorite subject, okay? So having asked that, I also want to ask, have you guys read any novels?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Just give me like one or two of you. What was the last novel that you read? Some names.
No. I read 40 Rules of Love.
40 Rules of Love. Okay. All right. So who was speaking to me?
Oh my God.
I know your name. Who was saying that?
Shabib.
Okay, Shabib. Okay, good. All right. Then, anyone else? Names of any novels that you have read? Come on.
Yes, ma'am. I read Wuthering Heights.
You read Wuthering Heights? Wonderful. Did you like it?
Yes, miss.
Okay. All right. So, who was that? You have to tell me your name also.
I'm Nita.
Nita, okay, all right. So I'm like assuming that, you know, you guys do read and you know what a novel is, right? You can answer me.
Yeah, you can unmute
and give me an answer.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, yes, ma'am. Okay, all right. Then tell me what is a novel. Tricky, I was leading to that question. What is a novel, in your opinion?
In my opinion, novel is a long story.
It's true. You're right.
It's a work of fiction. Yeah.
It's fiction. It's a work of fiction. Yes. It's a long story. It's fiction. Then. Do you know, like, before I get into, you know, more details about this, okay, let me just say that this is MEG3 and British novel, okay, and we will be talking about how the whole thing of novels originated, okay. Actually, this started in England. We're talking about British novel. So this started in England around, like, the 18th century, okay, so that is, like, late 1700s. And, if I ask you, you know, why did, like, so many other forms of writing was already in existence in the world by that time? But novel was a relatively latecomer, right? Look at it. Late 1700s means pretty latecomer, right? Early 18th century, pretty latecomer. Why do you think it took so long for novel to originate?
The print media wasn't that developed.
absolutely correct. Yeah, the printing press, you know, Caxton's printing press was developed only around that time. And that is when, you know, reading material became more easily available to the people. Okay. Till then, you know, mostly the kind of literature that was presented or the kind of literary work that was presented used to be dramas, okay? Plays, you know, plays that were basically things that could be staged, enacted, and the illiterate people also could go watch them and understand. And particularly the purposes was to teach, okay, was to instruct, give moral instruction. So this was how they viewed anything that was related to, you know, literature, like dramas were presented, especially church, related to the church, okay? But when the printing press was made, you know, then books started getting printed, and this whole concept of education was also on the rise. People were making money also, and books getting printed, it made it easier for people, more and more number of people, to afford buying books. Okay, till then, you know, very few books were available, and that too only handwritten manuscripts. So that was not very easy for everyone to possess. But soon things changed with the coming of the printing press. Books became more easily available, and also people started viewing literacy as something very desirable. People started learning how to read, and then it was a gradual, I mean, it was a natural progression, you could say, going into reading books. And that is when this need for, you know, longer stories came up, and from plays we moved on to novels. Okay, so that is how novel developed. Clear to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, all right. Now, looking at my slide, okay, see, modern novel, it began to develop during the 18th century. And the term novel itself, you know, look at the word novel. It is something that comes from Latin novus, and it is also from the Italian novella. Okay. Now, there were many causes, like I was just telling you, there were many causes for the development of the novel. One is the expansion of the reading public. So, with the coming of the press, more and more people could afford to buy printed books. So reading public expanded. Literate people also expanded. Then growth of a new middle class. So industrial revolution was happening. People were making things, selling it, making money. So there was a whole new middle class rising up who could afford to buy these books also. Now, women also were becoming, you know, learning to read, becoming aware of their positions in society and wanting to know more. So that is also another reason. So there was a change in the way women were positioned in society at that point in time. Then also economic reasons. So more available cash in their hands because of all the industrialization and the factories and all that. So they could afford to buy books. Now, these were the reasons for the development of the novel. Then going further into that, see, people who were richer than before could afford buying books, and women had more time for reading because after the Industrial Revolution, they had much more free time at home. More machines were made, right? So they could, you know, whatever work that they had to do earlier, some of it could be assigned to machine. So they kind of had more time at home and wanted to read. Then publishing as a business became something which is very profitable. Okay. And because there were more people who were willing to read books, this became very much in demand sort of business. That reading as a form of entertainment among the wealthy middle class. So like, you know, probably we go on social media or something, reading was like that for them, you know. So wealthy middle class who had time and the affordability could read. Then professional writers also, they found good occupation writing essays and books. So this was how the whole form of the novel came into being. All right. So one thing I just want to tell everyone, if you want, you know, you guys can start a WhatsApp group and I can send you more links related to certain topics that we discuss here. Because for those who are interested, you know, there are such a lot of material available there out in the net. And if you want, I can send you some links. Okay. which I don't have time to discuss so much over here. Okay, going on to the next slide. So 18th century British novel, Tom Jones. So this is the first novel that we will be studying in our course. We have 9 novels, okay? So this is the first one. I don't know whether you can see my image here. See, this is a book, okay? I'm sure many of you already have the book with you. So this is the first novel that we will be doing, the 18th century British novel, Tom Jones, okay? Now, 18th century novel was labeled as a realistic novel. Why realistic novel? See, the characters were real people with ordinary names and surnames. They were aimed at reaching the middle class audience. So people with ordinary names, okay, ordinary lives, that was something that would, you know, really ring a bell with the readers. So this was a realistic novel talking about ordinary peoples with whom the readers could completely relate. Okay. Then important novelists of this time were writers like Daniel Defoe, Jonathan Swift, Samuel Richardson, Henry Fielding, and Lawrence Stern. These are all names that you can be familiar with. We have Henry Fielding to study. Then Henry Fielding, see, he was the first English novelist to introduce the burlesque element in the novel. He defined his novels as comic epic poem in prose. So burlesque element in the novel. A burlesque element is something that has, you know, a comic exaggeration which imitates something else. Okay, so comically imitating something else. A current trend or something which is comically exaggerated and imitated. That is what is called as burlesque. And he was the first English novelist to introduce this burlesque element in the novel. So this comic form was introduced by Henry Fielding in literature, in English literature. And he defined his novels as comic epic poem in prose. If you would like, I can just send you a link of what is burlesque, okay? Let me try sending this to you. Oops. Get that? I just sent you literary terms. By the way, while I'm at it, I'll also send you this YouTube video that those who are interested can watch. This is about how you know, the novel originated and developed in literature, in English literature. I can, Shabib, you're right, I can share it there, but you know, I'm just sending it so that those who are interested can take it from here. Okay. Yeah, definitely. If you're going to start a WhatsApp group, it's better that way also. Easier for me. All right. So going back here. Okay. So can you all still see my PowerPoint?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So Tom Jones, Henry Fielding's third novel, okay? This was published in England in 1749. And Tom Jones is a picture of the life of the lower and upper classes of the 18th century society. Fielding depicts with humor and irony, human weaknesses and stresses, okay? These are the things that you will come across in this novel. We will be going into more details regarding all this, but I'm just putting it out there so that, you know, we become slightly introduced to it before we get into the details. Now, the kind of character that we are going to encounter in this novel, he is an unheroic character. His name is Tom and is an unheroic character who has all the limits of the ordinary man. So he's not a superhero, okay? He's not someone who's born with all the, you know, good qualities. He is a person who's very ordinary and has his own weaknesses. Now, Fielding's novels are considered picaresque in style. Okay, so we're coming across two new words here. Okay, burlesque and picaresque. Okay, picaresque in style, written in the imitation of Cervantes. Who's Cervantes? Who has heard of Cervantes?
Ma'am, excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
Does burlesque equate to irony?
Burlesque is not irony. This is comic exaggeration. Burlesque. Irony is something else. You say something, but you mean something else.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah, this is there is comedy in burlesque. Irony can have a more serious way of interpretation also. You understand?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah. And picaresque, see, look at this. This is another word that I'm introducing to you. Picaresque, okay? Written in the style of Cervantes. Now, who is Cervantes? Who can tell? Which book do you remember? Like when I say Cervantes. No? Don Quixote? Does that ring a bell? Have you heard of that?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so the author, the Spanish author of Don Quixote is Cervantes. And Don Quixote, you might have, you might be somewhat familiar with the story, you know, very eccentric knight, imagining that he is a very chivalrous and brave knight, out to, you know, rescue people, especially knights were famous for rescuing damsels in distress. And Don Quixote thinks that, you know, he is kind of a senior person, a senior citizen who has read so many romances that his brain has been addled. Addled means like gone, you know, completely kaput. And he thinks that he is a very brave knight, and he thinks he's riding a very powerful steed, a horse. But he's actually riding a donkey, and he thinks he's going on big adventures, saving damsels in distress, and he's fighting dragons, when in reality, he's actually, getting entangled in a big windmill, a large windmill. So these are the kinds of adventures that this hero has, that kind of style, you know, that kind of adventure, which deals with the adventures of a person who's of a lower social class, and also very funny, full of actions, full of excitement, in a very funny way. That is called as picaresque. So Tom is a very unheroic character, and he has all the many of the qualities of a picaresque hero. Okay? When we say picaresque, immediately we think of Cervantes and his novel Don Quixote. Okay, going on. So I've given the meaning of picaresque novels there. You can see that. Okay, going to the next slide. Now, fiction as history. So somebody, when I asked for the definition of novel, somebody said it's fiction. So fiction is something that is made up, right? But then when we read a novel, we know it is fiction, okay? Especially the fictional ones. But we still find elements of realism in that, right? So there are aspects of fiction that we can look at as history. Now, how do we look at that as history? Now, these are the points here. Oh, by the way, I just want to tell you something. All these points that I'm telling you, I have taken from your book, okay? Everything, all the material that I'm trying to give you is based on what is there in your book, okay? So fiction as history, novel as a realistic form. The reader may feel that he or she is witness to an actual happening in which real people have been involved, right? So compared to something else, like maybe poetry also, there is realism in poetry and drama also. But still, when you read a novel, it's a very realistic form. And we feel that we are part of something that is happening in the real world with real people. So that is one aspect of it. Then imaginative form. There is fiction as a totally imaginative form, which doesn't bear any relation with reality of life as we know it. Maybe a novel like Harry Potter or something, right? Although there are life truths in all everything, but settings and everything can be very, out of the ordinary world, right? So imaginative form also is there. And there is a fictional aspect also to novels. What is it? See? Invented tools that the writer uses to fulfill specific artistic, moral, or spiritual purposes. So the story could be something that is entirely made up by the writer. But at the same time, the writer is going to make full use of all the tools that fiction can give the writer in order to present to us, to the readers, an artistic work, something that is moral or something that has the capacity to enhance us spiritually. So these are also some of the ways in which writers use everything in their hand to try to tell us what they want to say. Now, the characters in a fictional work links with the period in which the writer has lived and stand for actual trends that existed at that time. So when we talk about realistic novels, the characters in the fictional works, they represent the characters as they existed at that point in time. For example, you imagine you're reading a period novel, right? Set in some period in history. The characters depicted in that novel will be acting as any other human being might have acted in that point in time, right? So when you look at it like that, you know, characters in fictional works are linked with the period in which the writer has lived and stands for actual trends that existed at that time. Okay? Then the society of a period becomes necessary component of fiction, right? If it is a novel that depicts a society of the current world, okay, whichever world that the writer wants to present, like for example, Charles Dickens, okay, Industrial Revolution, you find the conditions. Some people were getting more and more rich, but some people were getting poorer and poorer, right? That is, there was that sort of inequality, social inequality during that time. So the society of a period becomes a necessary component of fiction, and fiction then becomes significant history, right? When you look at it like that in a realistic fiction, with taking into consequence all the social factors that existed at that time, this becomes a representation of significant history at that point in time. Am I making myself clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
The novel is different from history in one important aspect. Okay, so what is the way in which the novel and history become different? Okay, one, see, history is a continuous process without a clear, tangible beginning and an end. Right? So history is something that is continuous, right? It's going to be there. I mean, it was there yesterday. It is there today. As we speak, we are making history, and it's going to be there tomorrow, long after we are gone also. So this is like a continuous process without any clear or tangible end, beginning and end. And novel, a writer writing a novel has to begin at a certain point and also ends at a certain point, right? Whichever point it is. So we can say that if the writer talking about society at that point in time is actually giving us a small picture of a moment in time, right? So the novel begins at a particular point of life in society and ends at another point. So this is a difference there. History is something that's like a continuous line, whereas in fiction, there is a beginning and an end. So we are trying to capture a moment in time. That is a difference there. Okay? Going on to the next slide. So 18th century shift, okay, so what is the shift that happened in the 18th century? The prose work in 18th century came to locate some new issues in society. So the issues that were in existence in society at that point in time came to be presented in the work written at that time. Now, what were the topics that really, you know, mattered to the people at that time? First one is marriage. It used to be, you know, something that was done as a matter of convenience, you know, like for purposes of inheriting property or wealth. So that was how it was, you know, it was not based on love or anything. It was more a matter of convenience. Now, marriage, which used to be a matter of convenience, changed radically in the first quarter of the 18th century as a whole set of new considerations like morality, ethics, love, courage, commitment, all these things came into beings, right? So there was a question of love, there was a question of courage, maybe courage to break the established ethics of society. All of those things came into being. men became more conscious and more honest. Okay? So till then, you know, they were less aware of things that were happening around them and didn't care whether they were honest or not, anything. So there was a change that you could see happening amongst the men, and the women also became more and more aware of their importance in society. Now, till then, women were practically like doormats, okay, not given any importance. The only thing that they were given importance was for bearing children, you know, getting children, taking care of the houses was the only thing that they were considered important for. So that was changing now. With the 18th century, this attitude towards marriage was changing. Men and women both felt changes in the way they were living. The second point is middle class, the rise of the middle class. Okay, so middle class, you know, a group of people who were hardworking, intelligent, faced the hold of upper class privilege, and they also became involved in policy making in the nation. So parliamentary affairs, a democratic force, so they became part of this whole policy making in the nation also. So middle class was fast rising to become a power to be reckoned with, not somebody to be pushed over, you know. So they were aware of how the upper class was treating them, and they tried to resist that also, and they were hardworking. The third point is fielding presence. This activated mass of people in England, and he lets them talk in their natural style, which is prose, the medium through which life in the market, the street, on the road, and the inn conducted itself. So what happens as a result when you come across, you know, in those days, you have to imagine people reading this novel in those days, okay? They find characters in the stories who think like them, who dress like them, who talk like them, where on the streets, in the inn, everywhere, you know, so that they could easily connect with such characters. So all over in England, you would find a shift, whether it was with relation to, family relationships, with relation to wealth, with relation to the way in which people live their day-to-day lives. So those changes were reflected in the novels also. Next one. So novel as a new literary form. So role of women, see, with time to relax at home, they turn to books, periodicals, to know how to dress, walk, or contemplate upon questions of right or wrong in life. So they had time in their hands, right? Because of the, you know, whole industrial revolution happening, and a lot of things were mechanized and everything. So women had more time, and they wanted to know, you know, with the wealth that they had, their husbands were industrialists making money. So they wanted to dress well, they wanted to talk well, everything. So they wanted to think about life, you know, what is right and wrong in life. And these women were the wives of men who had become very productive in organizing manufacture and of material employment of artisans and finding suitable markets. In short, industrialists. So these were people who were very skilled, you know, like industrialists who could manufacture things, who could organize manufacture, you know, bring in artisans, bring in workers, start manufacturing and start sending it out. So these were the wives of such people, and they had time in their hands, and they had the desire to improve themselves. Then another important reason for the novel becoming a new literary form is that market became a powerful center of activity and changed ideologies. Now, 18th century rise of periodicals. The city dweller went from parcel to periodicals. So not only was a market becoming a decision maker as far as, the way people thought was changing, ideologies were changing, market was making all the decisions, the money that the markets brought in was making all these decisions, and the activities also changed as a result of that. And 18th century, there was a rise in periodicals. Periodicals means like magazines, which were published at certain appointed time, like maybe once in a week or once in 2 weeks, bi-weekly or monthly, as it was published. Okay, so periodicals became very popular, and the city dweller started going to the periodicals instead of to the parson. There was a shift from the parson to the periodicals. What does that mean? From the church, you know, whenever they had any questions to be answered, any doubt to be cleared, they would go to the clergy, they would go to the church, to the parson, and ask these questions to the parson, who would give them very sensible, intelligent answers. But now they didn't need to go there. Instead, they turned to the periodicals, because periodicals were covering all sorts of topics, answering all sorts of questions. So 18th century, rise of periodicals was another reason why novels started becoming more and more important. Because, you know, many of the stories that were published as monthly stories that used to appear in the periodicals later came to be put together as novels also. So novel as a comedy started questioning social manners of the time. Principles of orthodoxy came under criticism. Love, individual choice, overcoming social inequalities were welcomed. The common man wanted a change in the way they were living. So they wanted to question everything that had been hitherto accepted, whether it's the question of love or individual choice or even overcoming social inequalities. The ordinary man was ready to ask questions and get answers. 18th century was overall a period of transition, and novelists echoed these changes in their writing. So you find all these changes. This was a time when a lot of changes were happening in England, in the society in England. And that is really reflected in the works of these writers, Fielding being no exception. Now coming to Tom Jones. Okay, so Tom Jones, published in 1749, is a comedy which is amusing and ends well. So already I'm telling you that it ends well. It's not a tragedy that we're going to study. It's a comedy which is, you know, amusing and also has a happy ending. What more can we ask, right? Then, originally entitled The History of Tom Jones, the Foundling, the book tells the story of the title character from infancy through his marriage to the beautiful and virtuous Sophia Western, the pursuit of whom takes up much of the tale. Okay, so the major part of the story, I mean, most of the story, is about how Tom Jones, who's a foundling, grows up from infancy to the point where he marries the woman of his, you know, the woman he loves, called Sophia, and how he comes to marry her. The pursuit of this woman, he finally comes to marry. So what happens in his life? Now, you might have noticed that the original title of this book was The History of Tom Jones, a Foundling. What is a foundling? Does anyone know?
From an unnamed child?
A child. Like, they found this baby on the bed of the master of the house. Okay? Nobody exactly knew who's the father or the mother of this child. So, foundling. So a baby whose parents are not really known about. Okay? So this is about the story of Tom Jones, a foundling. This was a original title of this novel. Later on, the novel, the title became Tom Jones. And this was published in 1749. A little bit about Fielding. Okay. Now, this was also like something about, you know, what had happened in Fielding's own life. Okay. So he used to be married to this lady, forgetting her name, and she passed away. And soon after, he loved his wife very much, okay, and considered her very respectfully. But after she passed away, he married her maid, his wife's maid. She was already pregnant with him, okay. So he married her. Okay. And society, you can imagine, okay, the fingers that might have been pointed at him when he did this. So how society looks at certain people, you know, like branding them and accusing them. So he wanted to write about such experiences. Some of that is echoed in the story of Tom Jones. Okay, just mentioning it along the way. Now, see, along the way, Fielding relentlessly satirizes the hypocrisy and vanity of most of his supporting cast. So people who are hypocritical, people who are vain, right? Hypocritical, like, you know, false standards, right? They have double standards. And also vain, you know, feeling of, okay, I am this, I'm that, very vain about oneself. So Fielding, the writer, criticizes all these aspects of the people through some of the other characters that you find in the novel. He shows that the lusty rascal Tom is in fact an infinitely better human being than the vicious pretenders who surround him and scheme against him while camouflaged in a thin veneer of artificial virtue. So Tom doesn't pretend that he's like, you know, holier than thou or anything. Okay, Tom is an ordinary human being, yet he's more human than any of the characters who pretend to be like very angelic in this novel. Okay, so there are characters around him who plot and conspire against him, and they just, you know, camouflage themselves in a veneer of artificial virtue. They kind of cover themselves in artificiality, pretend to be good, while at heart they are vicious serpents. Okay, and Tom, although he appears as a rascal, as a lusty rascal, because he has infinite number of relationships with women, he's described as a lusty rascal. Yet he is more lovable as a human being than these other characters. Okay, the hero overcomes not only all external plots and obstacles, but most importantly, his own weaknesses of character to win both love and fortune. Such a person is a real hero, right? I mean, nobody is born without faults, right? We all have our own faults, but realizing it, especially Tom, you know, he grew up with, I mean, hardly any support as a child whose parents are not known. You know, you can imagine that in those days in society, he was just called as, you know, an illegal son, right? Not given any respect or any importance. So he grew up like that with a lot of shortcomings. Yet, and of course, as a result of that, he fell into a lot of bad ways also. But as a human being, he was able to overcome, you know, the aspects of a human being's character that distorts their behavior. He understood that in his own character, and he was able to alter it, change himself. And you see a completely altered Tom towards the end of the novel. So he was able to, at the end of the novel, he was able to win both the love of the woman he loved and also the fortune that was required in order to succeed in the world at that time. Okay, going on to the next slide. Are you all with me?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I want to inform you one thing. We have started with the WhatsApp group.
Yes, ma'am.
No, someone said something. I didn't hear properly.
Ma'am, we have started WhatsApp group, so you can join and share every material there.
I will do that. You started it while I was taking class. You started it while I was taking class.
What?
Did you start the WhatsApp group while I was taking class?
Oh, yes.
Okay. You're supposed to listen here, okay? All right. So I'm going into more detailed summary, okay? Going into the more detailed summary of the novel. All right? So let's get to know all the other different characters also. Now see, the book opens by explaining Tom Jones' origins, where Allworthy is kind and noble man who one day comes home to Paradise Hall to find a baby on his bed, abandoned by his parents. He entrusts the child with his sister Bridget while they try to find out where the baby came from. Village gossip points to a woman called Jenny, so Allworthy brings her in for questioning. So this is how the book begins, okay? The novel begins by Squire Allworthy. He is one of the main characters here, okay? He's a rich man, prosperous lord in that area, owns a large estate, and he comes to find, his home is called Paradise Hall, and he comes to find a small baby on his bed, and he doesn't know, you know, who its parents are. That is our Tom, okay? And he entrusts the child with his sister Bridget while they try to find out where the baby came from. And the village gossip points to a maid, you know, called Jenny. So Allworthy brings that Jenny in for questioning. And Jenny admits to being the child's mother and to abandoning him, but refuses to say who the father is. Okay. So Allworthy gives her money, chastises her, scolds her, gives her money to leave the area and start a new life, and decides to bring up the boy himself with Bridget's help, with her sister Bridget's help. She's unmarried. Okay. Allworthy gives him the name Tom Jones. The townspeople assume that he must be the father because of his kindness. So this is what people think. Okay, he's showing kindness to this boy found on his bed. So he must be the father, and he's showing kindness to the boy. Allworthy is a childless widower with no intention of remarrying. So his estate will be inherited by any children Bridget has. So he has only one sister, no children. And whatever money and wealth that he possesses, and he is very wealthy also, will be inherited by the children of his sister Bridget. A man called Captain Blifil seduces and marries her and tries to get rid of Tom, because Tom is the, you know, adopted son. So he didn't want Tom to be in the picture at all. He wanted the son of himself and Bridget to become the heir to all the wealth of Squire Allworthy. So Captain Blifil seduces Bridget, marries her, and tries to get rid of Tom, as Tom threatens his children's inheritance. Okay. So Blifil convinces Allworthy that Tom's father is a school teacher at whose house Jenny worked. But the squire insists on keeping Tom. Blifil dies soon afterwards, but not before Bridget has his child. Okay. So Captain Blifil got married to Bridget and they have a son. Okay. But then the Captain Blifil, the husband, dies soon after. And none of them want Tom around because they are scared that the inheritance would go to Tom. Now, the child that Bridget and Captain Blifil have is also called Blifil. Okay, don't let that confuse you. So the child that is like Tom's cousin, okay, he's also Blifil. So the story then jumps 12 years forward, and Tom and Blifil are teenagers now. And they have been raised together and educated by two men, Mr. Thwackum and Mr. Square. Okay. Now these two are good for nothing characters, okay, who are always jealous and envious and trying to poison the years of Mr. Allworthy, the teachers, okay, Mr. Thwackum and Mr. Square. Now Tom is a rowdy boy who's always getting into trouble and as such is disliked by his teachers. Blifil is well behaved but secretly jealous of Tom. So Blifil is not such an angelic character at all. He is very jealous of Tom, but he tries to behave well. Whereas Tom is like, you know, no restrictions, gets into all sorts of trouble. Tom has an affair with Molly Seagrim, the daughter of his friend and gamekeeper, Black George. Meanwhile, he falls in love with Sophia, the daughter of Allworthy's neighbor, Squire Rester, and she loves him back. However, they cannot be together because Tom is not well-born and Western would never accept him as a suitor. So Molly Seagrim is the first woman that Tom makes love to. Okay. And she is the daughter of his friend called Black George. They have a large family. And he also happens to meet Sophia Western. Sophia Western is the daughter of Squire Allworthy's neighbor, Mr. Western. Okay. And they also have a large estate. And Sophia's father, in fact, wants her to marry Blifil, because if they both of them marry, you know, their estates could be joined together and they would become wealthier. And he would not approve of Tom as a husband for Sophia at all, because Tom was not a legitimate son and he would not inherit all the wealth of Squire Allworthy. So that's why Tom is not given any importance by Sophia's father. He would not accept him as a suitor for Sophia Western. So the second part of the summary. Allworthy gets sick and almost dies, but he recovers. Instead, news arrives by a letter to Allworthy that Blifil intercepts. Blifil opens the letter, intercepts the letter, that Bridget has died during a trip. So Bridget, that is Squire Allworthy's sister, has died during a trip. Tom gets drunk, celebrating Allworthy's recovery, and he goes to meet Molly. Blifil and Thwackum see them together and later gang up on Tom to fight him. And Squire Western intervenes on Tom's behalf at that point. Meanwhile, so Squire Western and Tom are good friends, okay? Only that he doesn't want him to marry his daughter. Meanwhile, Squire Western's sister, Mrs. Western, concludes that Sophia is in love with Blifil. Okay, quite wrongly. She suggests the match to Western, who is delighted, as Blifil is rich and their union would allow Sophia to remain close by. Blifil also likes the idea. When they realize that Sophia does not love him, Western locks her in her room until she changes her mind. Okay, so Sophia does not love Blifil, but you know, all around her, people want her to marry Blifil. So this is an exactly, like, I mean, exactly the kind of situation, you know, that where you can see the woman not being given the right to exercise her choices, isn't it? She loves Tom, but the family would not hear of it. And the reason is mainly for reasons of inheritance, for property. Now look at the way this shows how women are being treated at that point. And the father is, you know, locks her up in her room, which is an act of violence, right? So Western realizes it's Tom who Sophia loves and becomes enraged at him. He goes to Allworthy to expose Tom's bad behavior, supported by Blifil, who claims that Tom attacked him in the night of the fight. And Allworthy is very disappointed. He feels like he has no choice but to kick Tom out. So they go and poison the ears of Allworthy. Western wants to get rid of Tom's presence there, and Blifil also has lots to gain if Tom is out of the picture. So they go and tell all lies to Mr. Allworthy. And Tom is kicked out of Allworthy's house. Now, meanwhile, Sophia manages to escape with the help of a maid and plans to go to London, where she has a relative. So she knows if she stays on in some such child, she's going to get in trouble. So she runs away from her home and tries to go to London. While on the road, Tom meets and befriends a man called Partridge, was revealed to be the schoolmaster that Allworthy believed was Tom's father. Okay, so nobody still knows who was the father of Tom, right? And Allworthy had thought at one point that Partridge, the school teacher, could have been the father of Tom. And Partridge denies this, but the two agree to travel together. So both are going to London. At one point, Tom saves an older woman called Mrs. Waters from a murderer and beds her in a nearby inn. See, this is what I was saying, you know, Tom's energies are almost animalistic, you know, unrepressed. And he does have a series of relationships, physical intimacies. First, it was Molly Seagrim, and now he saves an older woman and he sleeps with her, the woman called Mrs. Waters. A man called Mr. Fitzpatrick, looking for his own wife, barges in, but leaves after seeing that Mrs. Waters is not Mrs. Fitzpatrick. So that happens also. Keep that in mind. We'll come back to that later. The next morning, Partridge mentions that there was a woman looking for Tom the previous night. So the night that Tom was spending with Mrs. Waters, another woman came looking for him. And Partridge informs him the next day. But then, you know, that was Sophia. Sophia who had come looking for him. So Tom understands that Sophia had come looking for him and found him in bed with another woman, and she was distraught and she had gone away from there knowing about his infidelity. Infidelity means lack of loyalty. So now that Tom knows Sophia is on her way to London, he decides to look for her. So Tom also decides to go to London. Now Tom's search for Sophia in London attracts the attention of the relative with whom she's staying. That lady is Lady Bellaston. Lady Bellaston takes a liking to Tom and wants to keep him as her lover. He accepts, knowing that she can get him closer to Sophia. So he understands that Lady Bellaston is trying to, you know, get him to sleep with her. And he takes money from Bellaston for that also. Lady Bellaston takes care to keep them separate. So Lady Bellaston has very selfish agenda of her own. She promises Tom that I will let you meet Sophia, but she never wants to let them meet. So she takes care to keep them separate, but they do meet eventually. And Tom begs forgiveness for his transgressions and Sophia grants it, but they still cannot marry. Why can't they marry? Why can't Sophia and Tom marry? Sophia loves him. He loves her.
Ma'am, because Tom is a fondling. He is not a legitimate child.
Exactly.
Till
that
now.
Is the reason. Yes. Now that is society playing its part there. Okay, so still Tom is not eligible to marry Sophia. Now, story goes on. Lady Bellaston comes home while they are talking and is immediately suspicious. She decides to marry Sophia to Lord Fellamar and suggests to him that the only way Sophia will agree is if he rapes her, right? If a woman has been, you know, the term that they use those days, dishonored, okay? Then she has to marry that man, Lord Fellamar. Lord Fellamar. I mean, look at it from today's perspective. They made the woman, they were thinking of trying to make the woman marry her rapist. Unthinkable, right? Totally unthinkable. So just as this is about to happen, Squire Weston arrives to fetch his daughter and drags her away to his inn, insisting she will marry Blifil, who is on his way to London. So then comes the father. Okay, now father is also acting as another violent person, totally repressing her, dragging her away and locking her up and insisting, forcing her to marry Blifil, whom she hates. So Mrs. Weston chastises her brother for his rough treatment of Sophia. Mrs. Weston asks that Sophia stay in her inn instead, guaranteeing that she will see Sophia married. However, Lady Bellaston has conspired with Mrs. Weston, who intends to have Sophia marry Lord Fellamar instead due to his high social status. Okay, so Lord Fellamar was a very, you know, highly connected person. And even Sophia's aunt, Mrs. Weston, wants her to marry Lord Fellamar. So there is nobody on Sophia's side. Whether it is Lady Bellaston, whether it is her aunt Mrs. Weston, whether it is her father, anyone, okay, none of them, you know, is there to help her. So Lady Bellaston decides she wants no one else to get Tom. So she arranges with Lord Fellamar to have him kidnapped by a gang and shipped off on a boat. Meanwhile, Tom runs into Mr. Fitzpatrick again, who once again accuses him of sleeping with his wife and attacks him. In the fight, Tom stabs Mr. Fitzpatrick and the whole thing is seen by Lord Fellamar's gang. And they take Tom to the authorities and accuse him of murder. So there is another battle, like another brawl or fight that happens between Tom and Mr. Fitzpatrick. And Lord Fellamar's people, they accuse Tom of being, you know, involved in this fight and getting Mr. Fitzpatrick wounded, and they take him to jail. Then going to the next slide. So the fourth part of the summary. Tom is thrown into prison, but it's not long before Mrs. Waters comes to visit him. She says that Mrs. Fitzpatrick has surfaced and clarified that it was her husband who started the fight and that Mr. Fitzpatrick is going to be, you know, healing from the wounds that he has. So Tom is said to be released. So things do not get very ugly, too ugly, because Mrs. Fitzpatrick comes and clears the name of Tom. And Mr. Fitzpatrick also, he doesn't die. He recovers from the wounds that he has. Okay? So Tom is released from prison. And as Mrs. Waters leaves the prison, Patridge comes to visit Tom and is shocked to see her. He recognizes Mrs. Waters as Jenny, his former employee. You remember Jenny? Jenny was believed to be the mother of Tom, right? Mr. Squire Allworthy thinks that Jenny was the mother of Tom. And he gives her money and sends her away. And later on, when she comes to London, she becomes Mrs. Waters, okay? And Mrs. Waters is the woman with whom he has been sleeping, you know. So that becomes like, you know, when Patridge sees Jenny, he remembers her and he understands that this is the same woman who was believed to have been Tom's mother. So there is this tremendous sense of, you know, guilt. Has he been sleeping with his own mother?
Incest.
Incest, yes, exactly, incest. Okay, so he recognizes Mrs. Waters as Jenny, his former employee, and tells Tom that he has slept with his own mother. So Tom is disgusted beyond himself with this, okay, and he sees his lewd behavior as the cause of his tragedy. So he understands, you know, this is not the way to live his life, right? He's been, you know, his lustful life has led him astray quite a lot, and he understands that it is his lewd behavior, lusty behavior, that is the cause for this tragedy. By this time, Allworthy and Blifil have arrived in London to follow Tom's verdict. Patridge goes to Allworthy to explain the situation, but Mrs. Waters reveals that she was not Tom's mother at all. Okay, she was not Tom's mother after all. So then comes the reality. Who was really the mother of Tom? Okay, no, it is not Jenny, it is not Mrs. Waters. But then who was the real mother of Tom? Now, Tom is actually Bridget's son. Okay, at that point, you know, like there was a young scholar staying in the house of Squire Allworthy called Summers. His name was Summers. And Bridget had this baby with Summers, that young university student who was staying in Squire Allworthy's house at that time. So Bridget is the mother of Tom, and Bridget has conspired with Jenny at that time when Tom was born. She had asked Jenny to take this upon herself so that her bad name would be spared. So Bridget had conspired with Jenny to hide this since he was born out of wedlock. And when Bridget saw that Allworthy was willing to accept Tom as his own, even without knowing they were related, she decided to keep quiet about it. And she intended to reveal this as she was dying. But Blifil intercepted the letter, kept the secret, and scared of the threat to his inheritance. So Bridget had written all this in her letter, the letter that Blifil had gotten and hidden away, because he did not want anyone to know that Tom was the real inheritor to all the estate of Squire Allworthy. Upon hearing this, Allworthy disowns Blifil, accepts Tom as a sole heir. Sophia forgives Tom for his indiscretions, and the two marry happily. So this is how the novel ends. Now, Fielding lays out this plot very meticulously, very neatly, neat and tidy plot. Okay? Each book in the novel is preceded by a literary essay in which he discusses the themes that will be explored in that book and exposes his reasoning for the progress of the story. So there is before each chapter begins, there is kind of an introductory chapter by the author talking to us directly, talking to us readers directly as the narrator, telling us why this chapter is coming on, what is the reason for having that chapter there, and how does it figure in the progress of the story. He lays out his attempt to write a new form of text in detail, giving the reader insight into why the action proceeds as it does. So this is something that you find, you know, pretty almost unique in this novel, where the author comes directly as the narrator and talks to the readers. Let me go to the next one. So we're going to look at, just a minute. Yeah. So we're going to look at, you know, the characters now, okay? One by one, the characters. That's a picture that I took it from the internet, okay? Finding, you know, Squire Allworthy finding the baby in his bed. So first, let's look at this character of Squire Allworthy. As his name implies, is also an allegorical figure of sorts. Allegorical means, like, you know, everything stands for something else. Look at the name Allworthy. Allworthy. All plus worthy. Squire Allworthy. So the name stands for someone who is worthy, right? Allworthy. So he's a sort of an allegorical figure. His character does not undergo any dramatic changes, kind of remains the same from the beginning to the end. Allworthy, the novel's moral judge, giver of justice and mercy. Okay? So he is presented in the novel as one who is a moral judge of all the actions that happen, and also the one who gives mercy, right? He's the one who is allowing Tom to be forgiven and giving him the justice of becoming the heir to his property. So that is, those are some of the aspects of his character. Now, all the other side of it, okay? Although he preaches all these high principles of morality, he often makes misjudgments. So is he really all that worthy, right? So look at that. Look at how the word completely turns around, right? He often makes misjudgments, right? He does not understand that Blifil and the others are playing on him, are trying to give him wrong information. He fails to recognize the essential qualities of Tom, and he turns Tom away from his home, right? So he makes misjudgments quite a lot. Allworthy's blindness to the evil designs of his nephew Blifil and to Thwackum, the master, the teacher. Thwackum's cunning plans lead him to make mistakes which propel the plot of the novel forward, right? The novel plot of the novel moves forward because of all the mistakes that Mr. Allworthy makes. For example, it's Allworthy who banishes Tom from his county. So he has to leave his home, Paradise Hall, because Allworthy banishes him. So on one side, Allworthy, the name is there because he is the one who gives justice, the one who gives mercy, etc. But the other side of it, the ironical side of it is that he is not really also worthy because of all the misjudgments that he makes. So that is about the character of Squire Allworthy. Now going to the next character. So the philosopher and the clergyman, okay? The two teachers, we are talking about the two teachers, Squire and Thwackum. They were assigned the job of imparting moral intellectual guidance to Tom, and they are more instrumental in obstructing it. Instead of teaching Tom, they actually obstruct Tom from understanding anything or learning anything. Now, what does Squire do? See, Squire projects the secular atheistic outlook and lays stress on correct and consistent human behavior. Thwackum understands everything in strictly religious terms. So these two characters, the teacher Squire and Thwackum, one projects a very secular atheistic outlook and gives a lot of importance to correct behavior. And Thwackum looks at everything in terms of religion. Okay, but then the reality is that Squire and Thwackum mislead Mr. Allworthy. Although created as comic characters, their comic nature turns more dangerous as far as Tom is concerned. And Thwackum constantly beats Tom and praises Blifil. Thwackum, who claims to value religion above all else, seeks only his own good. He is totally involved with his own selfish gains. So they are not teachers who are really good. One is a philosopher and one is a clergyman. Clergyman means a man of the church. Okay. So Thwackum, who understands everything with relation to religion, is a clergyman. And Squire is a philosopher. This is a picture of both of them. So going to the next set of characters. So this is the picture of Tom. And what does Tom symbolize? So Tom's character stands out in the novel as one which is entirely unformed. Inability to adhere to a given code of conduct, conventions, traditions, and norms do not mean anything to him. So he is a character who is unformed, unmolded, okay? Like a lump of clay, totally unmolded. And he cannot adhere to any given code of convention, any norms or rules. He doesn't follow any of those. Okay, but then see, he has good qualities. See, naturally kind and generous, and he suffers for it. He jumps into helping others without thinking of what will happen to himself, and he suffers because of that. Okay. So the naturally kind and generous Tom suffers for jumping into situations where he forgets his own benefits. Then he treats women as equal to men. In those days, when women were treated as lesser than men by everyone. Okay, just treated as possessions to have, just for the sake of, you know, marriage or childbearing. Tom treats women as equal to men. In that way, we can say Tom is more human than male, which is a gender construct, right? What do I mean by that gender construct? Human and male. You know, he possesses qualities like softness, kindness, honesty, empathy, qualities which are more womanly. Do you agree with this?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So, softness, kindness, honesty, empathy, these are all qualities that we associate with women.
These are basically gender-defined roles which society is laid down, but there is no definite role how a man or a woman should be.
Exactly. That's what I wanted to hear. See? So that's why, see, look at the quote that I have put there next, okay? One is not born, but rather becomes a woman. You know, Simone de Beauvoir, whose groundbreaking book about feminism called The Second Sex, she writes that one is not born, but rather becomes a woman. What does that mean? Like you just said, you know, these are gender constructs that are put forward by society, right? One can be biologically born a woman, but what a woman does, what she is expected, all these are things that society puts on her head, right? And what a man is supposed to be, that is also something that society puts on the head, right? It's not something that as human beings, we are naturally born with, right? But then as we grow, depending on where we grow, right? Depending on the environment in which we grow, these are all tags that become attached to our personality. So, you know, sex is something that is biological, but gender is something that is constructed by society. That is what is the meaning of this, okay? So, looking at it from that perspective, we can say that Tom was more, you know, kind and honest and empathetic to people around him. In that sense, we can say he was more human than everyone else around him. Okay, so these are the qualities that as a character Tom has. Although he gets into all sorts of misadventures, we still like him because of these human qualities. So Tom is innocent, hence often gullible. Okay, so when one is too innocent, they believe everything that people tell them, right? Gullible, can be easily led astray by people who want to fool him. So Tom, because of his innocence, okay? Now, Tom is courageous, fearless in the fight. He doesn't think about himself at all before he jumps into a fight. Like, how, for example, how he rescued Mrs. Waters. Tom, a character, more an idea than a realistic character. So Tom is, you know, critics have said that Tom is more of an idea, kind of like an ideal rather than a real character. Okay? So has lots of good qualities, but also lands in a lot of misadventures also, which actually makes him pretty human also. Now look at the relationships in the novel. Okay? Sophia, beautiful and elegant. Her father tries to force her into marrying Blifil, whom she hates. She runs away from home. As a character, you know, she's shown as someone who's very disciplined, introspective, and kind of a thinking individual. What about Tom? He acts before he thinks, right? So Sophia is the opposite of that. Very disciplined, introspective, and thinking individual. Now Tom, look at Tom's characteristics. See? Very easygoing, natural, and spontaneous. Could weaken and lose himself in anarchic self-destruction if not aided by rational self-appraisal. Okay, so if he's not helped by very logical self-appraisal, he would, you know, just completely go haywire and lose himself in total anarchic self-destruction, lawless self-destruction. So a kind of an animal spirit, you know, who does not know how to control himself. Self-control is not something that he has. Now, together, okay, Tom and Sophia, what are the similarities that they have? Both are kind and generous, okay? both have the capacity to rise above their immediate personal interests. So these are the characteristics that unite them. And Tom would sacrifice anything to win her hand. And Sophia too gives importance to duty over personal happiness. Because like for a long time, you know, she idealized her father. She said that she will only do what her father says. But then her father never gives her that same sort of respect or love, right? He just wants to use her to consolidate his wealth and property. So see, she Sophia gives a lot of importance to personal, to duty rather than personal happiness. Now, example is she asserts that she would choose her own husband. For example, she has her own strong individualistic viewpoint also. Although she obeys whatever her father says, she is very adamant that she will not marry Blifil. And she puts her foot down when it comes to marrying Blifil. Asserts that she would choose her own husband, not her father. Both are ready to self-sacrifice themselves for others. So there are similarities and differences between both of them, right? One is very thinking and the other one is very impulsive and spontaneous. Now, Squire Western, okay? The father of Sophia. Now look at this. See, Sophia is overly sentimental towards her father and her duty as a daughter. Squire Western does not hesitate to subjugate women, also his own daughter. So see, she is very dutiful as a daughter and she gives importance to her father. But then Squire Western is not able to give that same respect or importance to his daughter. And not only to his daughter, to women in general. He openly opposes a woman's right. And he is very conscious of money matters, even in his folly and vigor. So Squire Western is very, quite a fool in many instances. But even through all that tomfoolery that he has with Tom, he's very good friends with Tom. Okay, they go hunting and everything together. That is all on one side. But when it comes to matters of inheritance, he knows Tom is not the one that he wants for his daughter. Because matters of money and inheritance take precedence over anything else. So he's very money-minded that way. The yellow square there on the top right. See, Tom and Squire Western, they are friends. They hunt and dine and laugh together. When Western is pleased by Tom's successes with women, Western is conscious that Tom is a bastard. Mixing with him may not be socially acceptable. So see, they have all sorts of escapades together. They even, you know, celebrate making, going and sleeping with women and all those things they celebrate and enjoy. But in spite of all that, Western knows that Tom is a bastard and associating with him will not bring him any social acceptance. So Squire Western is an example of raw energy. And Tom also is like that, right? To a large extent, Tom is also impulsive, spontaneous, untamed, raw passion. So differences, Squire Western remains an untamed beast to the end. And Tom changes, right? So both are animalistic. But then what changes? Tom changes. Tom understands where he has gone wrong and corrects himself. So Tom becomes caring towards Sophia, unlike her father. So this is where the character of Tom, you know, although he begins out like almost like a beast, okay, with all animal passions let loose, he changes towards the end of the novel. So that is why we can say that, you know, he kind of, all the things that corrupt human behavior, we cannot say that Tom is an example for that, right? I mean, although he did suffer at the beginning of his life, and also as life goes forward in many instances, once he falls in love with Sophia, he realizes things about himself and he changes. That is where Tom becomes a hero. What about the women characters in the novel? So Bridget Allworthy is the mother of Blifil and Tom. An unattractive lady who resents beautiful women. Bridget marries Captain Blifil because he flatters her religious views. Now, her social position makes her appealing to Blifil, Thwackum, and Square. Bridget was a woman who was very aware of her social position, and she doesn't hesitate to make use of the, although she was very unattractive, she doesn't hesitate to make use of her social positions in order to let three men woo her. Finally, she marries Blifil. So both, all three of them, Blifil, Thwackum, and Square, were after her. She cleverly manipulates them and reduces the two to the level of abject seekers of sexual favors. She breaks the code of matrimonial sanctity. She has an attitude of counter violation of all of the all suppressing patriarchal code by a woman. So she's an example of a woman who dared to break all the patriarchal codes set for women by the patriarchal society, right? Because she had a son out of wedlock, right? So she is a woman who actually had the power to run against the codes of expected behavior for women, which was laid down by the patriarchal family, right? But then she also was aware of her own powers with relation to money and her social position to reduce these men who were after her to the position of abject sexual favors seeking gentlemen. So that is Bridget Allworthy, the mother of Tom and Blifil. Then the next character, Molly Seagrim and Mrs. Waters, the two women with whom Tom has relationship. Now, Molly, a symbol of human vigor and raw sexual power, quite a contrast to the scheming sexuality of Lady Bellaston. You remember Lady Bellaston, the woman who was plotting to keep Tom away from Sophia, Sophia's relative, right?
From London.
Yeah, she was quite a scheming person, and Molly is just the opposite of that. You know, symbol of human vigor and raw sexual power. So she's also kind of liberated if you look at it like that. Mrs. Waters, which is Jenny Jones' relationship with Tom. Now he's an object of seduction to which he undoubtedly succumbs easily, while Mrs. Waters is a seducer. So because he goes and has his relationship with Jenny Jones, right? Who is Mrs. Waters? When she goes to London, her name changes to Mrs. Waters. But then the question is, who was the seducer and who was being seduced? Okay? So the text says that Mrs. Waters was the seducer and Tom was more than willing to be seduced also. That is also there. Okay? So possibility of Tom having committed incest, Mrs. Waters' unscrupulous sexuality. So if that were true, it would be an example of Mrs. Waters' unscrupulous sexuality. But, so as the readers read, you know, there's an element of element of suspense, right? Has he committed incest, right? But then we know the truth afterwards. Now, character of Lady Bellaston. Her degradation and vacuity. Vacuity means emptiness, hollowness. Lady Bellaston is a London lady and a relative of Sophia, whose passionate, lusty personality leads her to dabble in intrigues. The stem of her last name, Bella, means war in Latin and points to her malicious nature. She thinks of no one but herself. And Lady Bellaston carries out a vengeful battle against Tom and Sophia with the utmost glee. Lady Bellaston's inherent fears as an insecure woman in the presence of Sophia's sweet and dignified ways. Look at the contrast, okay? So Lady Bellaston, whatever she does, reflects on her insecurities as a woman, as opposed to, you know, Sophia's dignified ways. Then Lady Bellaston, emptiness in London's high-class society. So she is a symbol of the emptiness in London's high-class society. People who have everything but are growing in loneliness and uncertainty as in her existence as a woman. So she doesn't find any fulfillment as a woman. She just finds loneliness, although she has a lot of money. That Tom absorbed in the thought of joining beloved Sophia, right? So Tom sleeps with her, and Lady Bellaston wants to keep him with her. And he agrees to that because he understands that staying with Lady Bellaston would be easier to find Sophia. And for the favors that he gives, he receives money from her. So he just takes it as a sort of transaction where he gets money for whatever he does. Lady Bellaston, jealous, uses her powers to thwart the efforts of the two lovers to join each other. So the character of Lady Bellaston, which is a character that shows degradation in the way in which she tries to keep the two lovers away and how she tries to take advantage of Tom, and also shows on another side the emptiness and the loneliness in her own life, which makes her do all these things. Role of the narrator. So the narrator of Tom Jones is an omnipotent narrator. Now what does that mean, an omnipotent narrator?
Who is
present everywhere. Ma'am, a narrator whose presence would be felt everywhere, like omnipotent God, we refer to God.
Okay, so in terms of a novel, how would we interpret that?
Maybe we can see his presence through his writing everywhere. Each character, in the molding of each character, you know, he's present everywhere. His hands are present everywhere that way. Okay. He never keeps his character free.
Okay. So let me give you some examples here, okay? Suppose I am the writer of the novel, okay? And I'm writing a novel, say maybe like Huckleberry Finn. Okay? You're familiar with Huckleberry Finn, right?
Yes, ma'am.
A young boy is the main character, right? So as a writer, I would be speaking like a 50-year-old woman or like an 8-year-old boy. Which one?
Think like a boy.
Like a boy, right? Because I want to give some sort of, you know, credibility to my character's voice, right? So as a narrator, I will be trying to, you know, speak like that. And suppose my narration is that of an 8-year-old boy, I can only describe what an 8-year-old boy sees in through his eyes, right? So I may not be able to have this omnipotence, this, you know, ultimate power of being able to look into the lives of every character and be able to speak from every perspective. I will only be able to speak from that particular character's perspective and what he sees. That would be describing the world. And we, as readers, would make out what is exactly happening. Okay? So the narrator's voice is the character who's telling us the story. When we read a story, the narrator is the one who's telling us the story. Okay, through whose voice do we hear the story? Do we read the story? That is a narrator. And the narrator can be like, you know, an omnipotent narrator or a limited perspective narrator who cannot see the point of view of all the characters, but through one character only. Here in Tom Jones, we have an omnipotent narrator who has the power to do whatever he wants, narrate in his own right, at times self-deprecating, funny, he contributes to sarcastic humor. So he has total power.
Anita?
Okay. Yes. Prema teacher. Hello, Prema teacher.
Hello, Anita.
Yes, teacher.
Anita, na.
Yes, teacher. I'm here. Can you hear me?
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Ah, yes. Good afternoon.
Oh, good afternoon, teacher. Okay.
Hello. Dear learners.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Anita, can you hear me?
Yes, Anita, I can hear you. I just muted my microphone. I thought I'll let you speak.
Anita, you can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, teacher.
Yeah. Good afternoon.
I can hear
everybody.
You, teacher.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yeah. Yeah, good afternoon. Good afternoon, good afternoon. You know me? The thing for me for the first time, I think. I'm the coordinator, Dr. Prema. And Anita ma'am and myself were colleagues for a long time.
Nice to meet you, ma'am.
Anyway, you will have been finish all the portions first. Okay, after that you can, in between also you can start writing the assignment. Did you form the group? Did you form a group, a WhatsApp group?
Yeah, they have.
Hi.
You've just joined.
Anita?
Yes, teacher.
They have formed a WhatsApp group?
Yeah, they've just formed a WhatsApp group. That's what they said.
So,
yes, ma'am, Shabib has created a group.
Ma'am, if you scroll up, you'll get a link.
Hello, Prema teacher, are you there?
She left, ma'am.
Okay. All right. So we'll wait for her to come back. Meanwhile, I'll go on with my presentation. Shall I do that?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
Anyway, I'm just reading the chats now. So I've started a WhatsApp group. And, you don't have my number, okay? Let me just write down my number here, okay? Can you add me then?
Sure.
I have to check my number. I keep it.
Ma'am, Prema ma'am is muted.
Now is it clear? Anita?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Okay, yes, we can hear teacher.
No, no, it's not mute.
Yeah, now
we can hear. Now we can hear. Earlier it was muted.
You can't hear. It is
now
not
we can.
Mute.
We can hear.
Just unmute. Maybe some other problem then, because okay.
We can hear you, ma'am.
So my dear learners, actually, okay, you can hear. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Anyway, we'll have a separate session later. For the time being, we'll finish the questions and all. Now, somebody wrote that you have already created a group, WhatsApp group. So, in that WhatsApp group, you can add us also. Okay. Then, next week or so, we will have a Google Meet. That means you can arrange a Google Meet so that you can clear all the doubts with regard to assignment writing, terminal examination, etc. Because I'm not stealing much time of Anita now. So now it's only 2 hours, and altogether you can finish the whole portion in 10 sessions actually. So there is no much time. So we can have a Google Meet somewhere in night or next week, because 13th is an exam. Okay. Up to 13th we are having exam. After that we will have a Google Meet. And who is the admin? Who's the admin?
I'm not sure who's the admin.
Hello?
Ma'am, Shabib is the admin.
Shabib is the admin.
Okay. So the admin, the admin.
Maybe somebody can add Prema teacher and myself also. I put my number there.
Only Shabib can add you, ma'am, because he is the admin.
Okay.
No, we can share the number, no, with them.
Yeah. Exactly. Some of you who are already in the group can share our numbers.
Is your number 9066333087? Is that your number?
My number, I'll just put it here once more.
Yeah,
9703327 02.
Okay. Ah, okay.
That's ma'am's number.
Okay. Prema teacher's number also I can put. Okay, let me just
ഞാൻ പ്രേമ ടീച്ചറുടെ നമ്പർ ഞാൻ കൊടുത്തോളാം അവർക്ക് എന്നോട് ക്ലിയർ ഓൾ ദ ഡൗട്ട്സ് ദ സ്റ്റുഡൻസ് ഹാവ് ആയിക്കോട്ടെ എല്ലാവരുടെ ഡൗട്ട്സും ക്ലിയർ ചെയ്യാലോ
I'll ask them to add your number to the
network
problem, so you can
I'll text you, I'll message you. Thank you, ma'am.
You know what, I'll just give you Dr. Prema's number also.
Ma'am, I have Prema ma'am's number. I have put in the group actually.
Okay, good.
Okay.
So then I need not give, right?
Yeah, I have already sent in the group.
Okay. All right then. So shall we get back to our class?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, going back to this. Oh my God, I don't know why this goes to the beginning. We finished all this, right?
We were doing role of narrator, omnipotent.
Yeah. Narrator, okay. Yes, omnipotent. Okay.
Thank you. I'm happy that you guys are listening. Okay, all right. So going back to the narrator, right? So here in Tom Jones, we have an omnipotent narrator who can do whatever he wants, and he has complete control and power over all the characters, and he decides. He's kind of like God, like you said, you know, all powerful. Potency is power. Okay, now the ironic intrusive narrator can be assumed to be Fielding himself. You remember I told you in this novel, before each chapter there is a particular chapter where the narrator is speaking to us readers directly as the narrator himself. So that can be the voice of Fielding himself. Okay, the ironic intrusive narrator who talks about what is going to happen in the next part of the story. Okay, who's talking to us directly, you know, as the narrator talking to the readers. That can be the voice of Fielding himself, because he reflects on his process of creating Tom Jones. So now going on to narrator. See, a highly intrusive, omniscient, third-person narrator who not only relates the story of its protagonist, but comments and regularly on the process of writing a story while also offering comments and asides. This is very unusual, you know. As a narrator, usually they tell the story, but they don't talk about this process of writing the story. So in Tom Jones, you find the narrator expressing himself before each section of the story begins, directly addressing the readers and talking about the evolution of the character, evolution of the story, and why each chapter begins the way it does or proceeds the way it does. So we can say that the narrator role of narrator in Tom Jones is one of a very intrusive narrator. He intrudes into everything that happens. Intrusive narrator, omniscient narrator, one who knows everything. Not only omnipotent, he's also omniscient, okay? One who knows everything. So all-powerful, all-knowing. Okay, and a third person narrator. A third person, he stands separate from everything else that is happening. He has his own voice, a third person narrator. Not only talks about the protagonist. Who's the protagonist? By protagonist, what does it mean?
Hero. Character of the novel.
Hero. The central character.
Main character, isn't it? The main character. So, not, and what is the opposite of that?
Antagonist.
Okay. So pronounce it protagonist and antagonist. Okay. So the story of its protagonist is narrated by this narrator, but he's also able to comment regularly on every other aspect of the writing itself. And he also gives comments and asides also. So there's another interesting element in this novel. You know, places as segments of life. Okay. So you find three different locations being talked about in this story. One is the countryside, Paradise Hall, where Tom grows up. Right? And then he goes to the city to meet Sophia in pursuit of his lady love. He goes to the city. And on the way, there is a part where he spends on the road. So there are three aspects, three different locations where the story takes place. The countryside, the road, and the city. Okay, so three distinct places in the novel. One is Somersetshire, where he spends his childhood. Then the road, which is like, you know, the paths, the town spread over the distance between Somersetshire and London. And then the city of London itself. So what do these three places signify? Okay, so Somersetshire, for him, for Tom, does not have any hope, holds no hope for Tom, because there he is an illegitimate son, a bastard child who is not given any respect or any kind of importance. Now the road, the second place, the road, okay, it stresses Tom and also makes, it stresses Tom's need to move and explore. It kind of emphasizes Tom's need to leave Somersetshire, move out of that place's comfort zone, rather we can say, and explore. Now the road is also the place where Tom is able to reach another place while joining with this like, which gives him the possibility of leaving where he was and reaching another place where he might be united with his love. So it kind of holds hope there for him, as opposed to Somersetshire. This road is not an easy road. It's a very rough and difficult road, both literally and metaphorically. By the way, what is this literally and metaphorically? What does it mean when I say metaphor?
I'm using a comparison to explain some similarities or differences.
Exactly. So here, the road is actually a journey, right? What do we do on a road? We journey to some place, right? So metaphorically speaking, this is a journey that Tom undertakes. He moves away from the wild, unrepressed, animalistic passions that he had when he was in Somersetshire. On the road, he's on this road to self-discovery. So the road is metaphorical in that sense also. And London, when he reaches London, it's a world totally different from where he's coming, right? So it's a world of intrigue, it's a world of scandal, it's full of crises that he has to overcome, full of dangers and difficulties that he has to overcome. So these three places are quite distinct as far as the novel is concerned. Now going to the next aspect. I have to tell you, like, you know, some things that are connected with novels, okay, both general and particular. Now, character in a fiction refers to habits, age, station in life, and relationships with one another. The dialogue assigns to characters helps to carry out their specific plan of action. Okay, so dialogues are important because we learn more about the story through the dialogues, right? It's not always through description that we understand the story. When characters speak with each other, we understand more. And also characters tell us a lot about the story, depending on the habits that they have, the age that they are presented in, you know, I mean, what is their age, okay? Their station in life, relationships with one another. So all of these things takes us further in the writer's specific plan of action. So this plan of action, loosely called the plot, which all characters are a part, okay? So this is what is called as a plot. One thing happens, then the next thing happens, and then the third thing happens, right? So first this happened, then that happened, and finally this happened. When we say that, we are moving through a story, right? So that is the plot of the story, okay? Now see, a plot is a plan or a sequence of incidents, okay? Writers pay great attention to make the account appealing, realistic, merging with depictions of society. It gains an identity of its own. So the story needs to have a plan, right? How does this happen? How does the action take place? First this happened, then that happened. And finally, you know, this is what happened. So that is a plan. That's what we can call as a plot of a story. Okay? Now, another important thing that you have to know here is point of view, especially in this novel. It clearly states a socio-ideological position. Okay, point of view. From whose point of view are we reading this story? In this story, Fielding is giving us a socio-ideological position, which offers sharp, ironical comments about characters, about issues that are not favorable. People and characters are ridiculed and expressed unambiguously, very clearly. Okay, so certain characters are made fun of very unambiguously. Ambiguous means doubtful. Unambiguously, very clearly. Then, the point of view is that of a socio-ideological position, talking to us about people as they existed in society at that time, laying open their hypocrisies, laying open their vanities, and also bringing to us the strengths in some of the characters. Like, for example, Tom moving from weakness to strength. Typical and individual characters. Now, typical characters made in the mold of the time in which they exist. For example, the clergyman or the maid, they are typical characters, okay? Clergyman, a clergy means from the church. Clergyman, the man from the church, the priest. Individual draws the reader closer through psychological projection. So when the characters are individually portrayed, different from, you know, a loosely sketched character, which is like a general character, typical stock characters. The clergyman, the maid, and all are stock characters. You'll come across stock characters in Shakespeare also. Now, individual characters are given more importance. It's like sketching, you know, giving more details into the sketch, right? Going deeper into their presentation, into their psychological depths also. Now, there are certain characters who are called round, certain characters who are called flat, certain characters who are called dynamic, certain characters who are called static. Do you understand if I say such terms?
Miss ma'am.
So, who are round characters?
Characters who go... whose characters go about changes and they are a different person as the story progresses and a completely different person at the end of the novel.
Okay, so a round character and dynamic character are basically the same thing. A character that is well defined is a round character. Okay.
What about dynamic should be basically action oriented?
Yes, dynamic character is one who does not remain static. Like, he is not the same person at the end. as he was at the beginning. So he changes on depending on the situations that the character goes through. He changes, he becomes more dynamic. Okay, so round and dynamic on one side. Okay, now on the other side we have flat and static. Flat characters are characters who are not given too much of attention or depth by the writer. Okay, they kind of remain the same from the beginning to the end. They remain the same. Static character, Allworthy example of a static character, does not undergo a lot of change. Whereas Tom is an example of a character who really changes, isn't it? Even Sophia's father does not undergo so much of change, right? So characters who are flat versus character who are round. Characters who are static versus characters who are dynamic. Okay, got it? Like, for example, in Shakespeare, you will have like a fool's character, a stock character, typical character. Generally, characters who are not given too much attention become flat or static. Jenny Jones character, as Mrs. Waters. Okay, so Jenny Jones has been shown in three different phases. As a young woman, when she found herself brighter than others. As a middle-aged woman trying to survive in London. Then other women detest her and she becomes a close friend of Miss Allworthy. Shows patience and forbearance in her behavior when Mr. Allworthy castigates her for the sin that she has not committed. So she is kind of loyal, right? She's kind of loyal to Bridget and sticks by her word to Bridget. She does not reveal who is the real mother of Tom. Because she had promised Bridget not to tell her, tell anyone. And even when Mr. Allworthy castigates her, scolds her, insults her, even then she doesn't reveal the true, who's the true mother of Tom. As Mrs. Waters, she undergoes a change and becomes a clever, calculating middle-aged woman. So when she comes to London, she changes. She becomes a very clever woman, calculating woman. Fielding shows how it was brutal rigidities of the society that changed her. Okay, so the brutalities inflicted on her by society that made her want to survive, and that is how she changed. At the inn, we find her in a highly oppressive situation. The threats held by economic subsistence, moral principles, social etiquette, manipulative strategies of the lower people, all forming a vicious network. She was attacked by a lot of people and on the way at the inn, and that's where Tom jumps in and rescues her. So at the inn, you know, we find her in a very oppressive situation. The stress of trying to survive, a woman in the city trying to survive on her own, economic subsistence, then the moral principles, how women are treated, how single women especially are looked upon by the men in the town. All of these things are form like a vicious network that she has to survive if she has to live in the city. So it's not an easy thing for Jenny or Mrs. Waters to survive. Okay, if you have heard of this writer called Virginia Woolf, she's written a book called A Room of One's Own. Have you
heard that? Yeah, I have read that.
You've read that, yeah. So you know there, you know, she imagines that suppose Shakespeare, who went to London and became very successful, right? What if he had a sister? What would have been her fate, right? That girl, if she had run away to London, would not have managed to get the same kind of success that Shakespeare had, because as a woman, she would be looked at differently by society. She would be treated differently by society, and she may not even have been able to survive all the difficulties that she had to face. So we find kind of like the same thing here. You know, Jenny Jones becomes a cold, calculating woman because she has to survive. So the character of Jenny Jones, and in her favor, we have how steadfast she was to the word she gave to Bridget. Now, although Mrs. Waters knew all along that she had never mothered a child, the question of incest raises horror, at the same time draws attention to greater depravity and hypocrisy in London society. So that kind of throws light on what could have happened in London society, where there was no question of morality or anything. So Jenny Jones is a character portrayed realistically in a highly patriarchal world. So a woman who really is tossed this way and that way by the rigidities and the harshness of a patriarchal world. So that is Jenny Jones' character. We kind of admire her through, you know, I mean, all this, right? Through whatever she's had to face, she still comes.
She owns her sexuality.
She owns her sexuality also, definitely. Okay? So we kind of admire her for that. Now the introductory chapters and their relevance, okay? So 18 books are there in the novel, and introductory essays, you know, so these books have like introductory essays, and the titles of these introductory essays where like the narrator is talking to us, the titles are like of the series in writing and for what purpose it is introduced. Then of love, of those who lawfully may and of those who may not write such histories as this. These are the, you know, some of the titles that you will find in these introductory chapters. So for Fielding, the most important aim of the novelist is to provide guidance as well as enlightenment to the reader rather than what is termed experience. So didactic purpose, like to teach a lesson, to learn from it, okay? Fielding performs two roles here, both as an entertainer and an educator. So we not only are entertained by all the adventures that Tom has, but also we learn what are the things that should not have been done. So educating us also. Fielding thinks it's appropriate to equip the reader intellectually to grasp the truth of the presented description and to judge for her or his benefit, the behavior, manners, and morals of the characters in the novel. This is what he does in the introductory chapter. So he kind of assesses what has happened to the character and kind of teaches the readers, this is what you're going to take from this, right? Which is quite unusual. Usually the writers don't really come and talk to us like that. We understand, we come to our own conclusions. But here, he takes this, you know, power of really addressing the reader and telling them, instructing them. So that's why he plays twin roles of both entertainer and educator. Now, another episode that is given importance in the novel is Man of the Hill episodes. Like when Patridge and Tom Jones are on their way to London, they meet a particular character, a very eccentric sort of character, and they're interacting with this character. That's what this is about. So the meeting of Tom Jones and Patridge, both travelers, with the Man of the Hill springs in the novel, a very extraordinary adventure. So this is something that happens on the road, on the way to London. And it's not merely in terms of an incident involving robbery and physical attack. It's also Tom's and Patridge's confrontation with a person who went through the highs and lows of life and experienced a great deal of pain. He has become a recluse. As a result of all the sufferings that this man has undergone, he becomes a recluse. And Tom and Patridge meet him. Now, these are his words, okay? Man of the Hill's words. Characterization of human nature. Man has been referred to as the king of the globe and the last and greatest work of the supreme being. There is the realization based on observation and experience that he is actually imperfect and a vile animal. So although we talk of man as the supreme creation of God and everything, we do have our own imperfections and we have a vile side to our characteristics. So this is something that Tom learns on as a part of Tom's changing process and as part of Tom's education. He learns it after meeting this Man of the Hill, who has been out there in the world, experienced everything, and has chosen to become a recluse from that. But then, so the difference between the Man of the Hill and Tom is that while one chooses to run away from the troubles, Tom learns from it and decides to confront life as it comes at him. Look at this. So that's the next part. Sorry. So contrast between the man of the hill and Tom Jones. See, man of the hills is a reclusive person and Tom is struggling, self-assured and honest. Differences, okay? These are the differences between them. Tom moves towards successful completion of his journey. So he doesn't run away. He faces life rather than running away. Their different attitudes come from two historical periods, late 17th century and mid-18th century. So Tom from the mid-18th century has more of hope and desire to face life as it comes rather than opt for a silent way out, like the recluse man of the hills. That's an important episode which is mentioned in your text also. Now the other topic that's mentioned in your text is feminist concerns in fielding. Now marriage in the 18th century England was used mostly to subjugate women for economic interests. It was seen as a socio-economic alliance. The conduct code of marriage suppresses women's spontaneity. Female sexuality and marriage stand in contrast to each other. Right? So Tom's affinity with women. He was uninhibited, pronounced relationships with Molly Seagrim, Jenny Jones, it makes him not lewd or lusty, but rather we can say it adds, sides to his personality, which makes him kind and considerate towards women, which no other male character in the novel is shown. Okay, especially you can see Sophia's father, how he treats her. Other male characters, see, Allworthy, although is shown as intellectual, does not treat women as equals. Square Western, that is Sophia's father. He's more interested in hunting, and Square and Thwackum, the other male characters, see, they do not understand the true meaning of gender relationships, just want sexual favors. And Blifil thinks of women as mere objects of sex. So compared to all of these other male characters, Tom is the one who really cares for and is more considerate towards women, although he does have this, lusty side to his character. Another important topic again that is mentioned in your textbook is the metaphor of poaching. Okay, poaching is like going and taking something that is unlawfully, not actually yours. I'm taking something unlawfully. That is poaching. Now, the metaphor of poaching is there in this book on three different levels. First is economic level. Second is the ideological moral level, and third one in terms of gender. Let's look at the first one. Poaching as social trespass. Okay, the wooing of Bridget Allworthy by various men like Dr. Blifil, Captain Blifil, Thwackum and Square, Blifil's attempts throughout the novel to outshine Tom exemplify the desire to absorb Allworthy's estates and property. So everything, all these people, whether it is Bridget Allworthy that has tried to be wooed and wed by these men who are eyeing her for her money, or whether it is Blifil who wants to conspire against Tom, again eyeing the money that is involved in Allworthy's estate. So these are all examples of social trespass, this economic poaching. So robbery connected with economic gains, right? Economic poaching serves to bring forth a society that is actually very, very acutely conscious of money and class. Okay? So poaching as social trespass. So trying to reach a more wealthier state. So that is economic poaching. Then the second one. Moral religious poaching in the text. Thwackum and Square not only try to impel Tom to follow their principles, but also prefer Blifil to him to hold on to the power structure. So they want Tom to follow them, okay? And also they prefer Blifil because Blifil was in the direct line of succession at that point. So they give more importance to Blifil. So that is also kind of poaching or robbery done in order to get personal benefits. So Square Western and his sister in their dealings with Sophia. So they also don't really care for Sophia, her aunt or her father. Both of them don't care for Sophia. They just want to use Sophia like a pawn in chess you know, to, in a game of chess, how people use pawns, right? Just like that, they are using Sophia in order to gain monetary benefits. So, moral religious poaching in the text. In this case of Squire Western and his sister, Mrs. Western, it is moral side, right? And the others, they are doing this religious kind of poaching. Then the third example is gender poaching. By gender poaching, one means that the novelist considers woman as merely a good device with the help of which he could drive his message home and further his plot. So you find, you know, woman being used by the writer to bring to the forefront many of the pitfalls that men face. So that is also kind of poaching there. And the questions that we ask ourselves is Fielding trying to present the 18th century society as it existed at that point? A realistic presentation of 18th century society. This is the way in which people dealt with each other. Or is he hinting at a universal phenomenon where men always dominated women, the patriarchal norm, which was something that existed then and still exists today, right? So what is he trying to do? These are questions that we can ask ourselves. Another important topic in the novel is pregnancy. Okay, the topic of pregnancy, you know, I mean, the whole thing starts from Bridget Allworthy's pregnancy, right? The whole story of Tom Jones comes from Bridget Allworthy's pregnancy, right? Pregnancy affects the lives of women alone.
Hello?
I guess ma'am's video got stuck.
Yeah, connectivity Hello? Must be lost right now. She'll come back.
Yeah.
Ma'am, we can't hear you. Are you there in the call?
Hello, ma'am? Can you hear me?
Yeah. Is she back?
She'll be joining again. Please wait for some time.
Is it timed or something? Is it all over 2 hours now?
Yeah. It's already 4:15 now.
She got disconnected. It is not that she canceled the call. There is a network issue.
She is continuing with something.
Yeah, we understand.
It could be that the meet has a particular time limit. Maybe that got tripped. That's why.
That's what I'm saying. You know, sometimes we normally time a particular meet for 2 hours, so it gets disconnected automatically.
Exactly. That must have happened.
But then it's end for all, no?
It's inaudible for all of us.
Yeah, so probably it's a connectivity issue.
Hari sir, are you there in the call?
We all are there in the call, but ma'am,
I'm talking about Hari sir. Hari sir, the person who is conducting this session. If he's there in the call, he could check with ma'am. The one who was sharing the attendance link.
In fact, the number, she has put it on the link, right? So why can't we can call her up, right? Just a moment.
Jennifer, do you mind asking, ma'am?
Hi, I just called, ma'am. She said us to wait for 5 more minutes.
Okay.
Yeah, she said us to wait for 5 more minutes. She got disconnected there.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We'll request her to share the PowerPoint presentation in the WhatsApp group.
Or we may ask her to, you know, go slow and run the slides again so that we can take screenshots if we need to.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Yes, ma'am, you can speak.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I'm so sorry for just, you know, disappearing like that. The thing is, something has happened to my computer. It's not working. It's just frozen up. And I just have a few more slides to complete. And we'll continue with this and complete it in my next class when we do the second novel. Just before I start with the second novel, I finish this and then go to the second novel. Okay? Is that all right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. No
okay,
problem.
Ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. I'll see you next week then. I'm so sorry about this.
It's okay.
No problem, ma'am.
It's okay, ma'am. No problem.
Okay.
So we can end the meet right now?
Yes.
Pardon? Ma'am, is it okay to end the meet right now?
Yeah, you can. Because, I mean, I'm so sorry. My computer is totally stuck.
It's okay, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you very much, ma'am, for today's session.
Thank you, ma'am.
I'm not able to hear you.
Yeah, everyone is saying thank you so much for today's session.
Okay. Thanks, everyone.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye,
ma'am.
Bye,
everybody.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Bye. Thank you. Bye-bye. Take care. Bye.
Have a nice day.